Welcome to our workshop on the Hanskan Query language and tips and tricks. This is my colleague Harm van Beek and I am Hans Henseler. And in this workshop we will take you through the Hanskan Query language. And as you might know, Hanskan is a very powerful platform which allows you to digitally, forensically investigate a large amount of data. What most people do not know is that Hanskan has a trace model and that we have a query language. It's a very powerful query language which allows you to drill deep into the data, to ask for different types of information from the model. So what we thought would be a good idea in this workshop is to have 10 different queries that might be asked by an investigator to a digital forensic expert if they can assist them with finding information. So here's a quick overview of what we want to do. So simple date search, find all artifacts from October 2021, which pictures were taken with a Samsung in the Netherlands, so geolocation. Which emails contain recognized phone numbers, so we want to match for entities. Which Bitcoin addresses are shared via Telegram? Now this is interesting, and Harm will explain how we do this, because we're not looking for the messages, no, we're looking for the actual Bitcoin addresses. So we're not getting traces, we're getting actually parts of traces. And we want to search for IP addresses, so regular expressions, how we're going to do that. And we do image classification with the famous FIRE library from the Netherlands Forensic Institute. How can we find pictures that contain firearms? And several other classifications are there as well. And how can you combine text search with date search? And maybe that they are not carved. So in this case, we will have an example with sexual abuse materials. And sometimes you want to look for duplicates. So if you find an attachment, if you find a document in an email, you want to know if this document occurs on any other material in your case. How can you do that with Hanskan? And finally, we do not only do classification of images, we can also detect if there are faces. And we actually put the number of faces that we have detected in a picture in the trace model. And we enable you to query for that particular field. And we'll show and we'll demonstrate how to do that. So without any further ado, let's dive in, Harm.
Yes,
and
thank you.
Really interested to see how these queries work. And if I don't understand, I will ask you to elaborate a bit. But I will have to be within the time.
Yes, thank you very much. So we just dive in them. First to start, find digital artifacts with a timestamp in October 2021. So as you might know, Hanskan has a trace model. We type everything, for example, the things shown here. And everything is typed and has properties, and a lot of these properties are of type date and time. So we know when a file was created, when an email was sent, when a document was printed. That's all dates and times. And you can search on specific things, like give me all the files created in 2021. But you can also combine them and query all dates that are known within a trace, independent on whether it's from a file timestamp or it's an email timestamp or whatever it comes from. And then you can do a dates search at once. So you can say, give me everything that happened in October 2021. Very simple query, just one small...
Hey, Harm, this is it's really great, especially that you can have this date filter and you don't have to care about what date you mean to search for. So if it's modified or created or sent. So that's great. And you showed the screenshot, so that's the... I think the expert user interface, right, of Hanskan. And for those who've used Hanskan know that this might seem complicated, and of course we have a manual, which is online, but if you start typing, so if you start typing, for example, file.created, there is an autocomplete. So Hanskan will actually prompt you with all the different possibilities. So it's actually a great reminder of what the syntax is. And if it doesn't match, it means you're making a little mistake, or it means that Hanskan didn't find any traces that match that particular query.
Exactly. And it's per case, so if you don't have file created on timestamps in your case, it will not autocomplete. And well, here you see a screenshot of the manual that Hans mentioned. And as you can see, it's very easy to query on date ranges. You can say everything in October 2021. And using the two dot notation, you can also make a more specific range for a few months or a few days, or even a few minutes.
Okay, well, so let's move on to the next query, Hans.
Yes, very good. Find pictures taken with a Samsung in the Netherlands. So this is a more advanced query where you want to combine multiple things. Namely, you want to find pictures. Well, that's not too complex. That's finding pictures with a specific camera model. Well, as you all know, picture have EXIF information. Hans can parse the EXIF information and puts everything it finds in the data model. And you can query anything. So everything would make Samsung will give you pictures taken with a camera of the make Samsung. And here you also want to do something with latitude longitudes, with geolocation. Well, Hansken extracts geolocation information from the EXIF information as well. And in this screenshot, you see it stores it in a lot long field and marks it as a GPS entry. And well, the Netherlands is a range. And in Hansken, you can search for ranges like you could do for dates. So you can say, give me everything with GPS lot long in this range, and it will present you with all pictures in this range taken with the Samsung.
So Harm, if I'm correct, then what you're doing here is you specify the lot long coordinates of the upper left corner and the lower right corner. So that's kind of, we're putting the Netherlands in a rectangle, right?
That's right. So you probably also will find a hit in Antwerp in Belgium.
Yeah.
But that's what it is.
Okay, well, excellent. And I assume that you can also look for lat long with just one location, you know, and then you can find a specific location where your pictures are being presented.
Exactly. So the example in the screenshot, if you type in that lat long, you will find this picture as well.
Okay. Well, it's good, great feature. I think it's very useful if you want to combine your searches, maybe add some text or classifications and location information.
Yes. Next one. Find emails that contain a recognized phone number. So what we do with Hansken is we also can find emails. That's not hard. Just say, give me everything of type email, and you will find your emails. And you can combine queries. You can actually make your filter smaller. So now we have all emails. We want a subset. And if you want to find phone numbers inside your emails, that's what we call a tracelet. So we have traces, emails, and smaller things inside traces we call tracelets. And one email can contain a lot of tracelets, as we call them, like phone numbers, but also a lot of other things. We will have some examples later. And actually, these tracelets are very small traces with a single type and with typically one or two properties. So if you want to look for, in this case, phone numbers, you can say, I'll give me all thing with entities of type phone number. And this query still returns emails, since you were looking for emails, but by combining it with the trace type phone number, it gives you all emails that also have entities of type phone number in them. And tracelets have a confidence since, well, a phone number might be a phone number, but every now and then we find a range of numbers that actually wasn't a phone number, but it looks like a phone number. So there is a confidence, and in the screenshot you can see the confidence. Well, there's two examples of Dutch phone numbers here. And those actually are phone numbers, though the confidence is one. And in this way, also in the user interface, you can find the emails, but also the entities contained in them are presented.
Yeah, that's great. So actually what you're doing now is you're searching for traces, and you are restricting them to type, and you're restricting them to entity, in this case phone number or something else. Well, is it also possible to turn it around? So can I find tracelets for a particular type of traces?
Yeah, so that's the next example.
That's the nice,
I
knew that, I remember that somewhere.
Yeah, so the other way around, we can also do it. So if you're interested not in the emails, but in phone numbers shared via emails or contained in emails, you can do it the other way around. We call that a value search, since you want to find values of properties instead of the traces themselves. And for the value search, we have in our expert user interface a specific window. And it's contained in the menu. Click on the value search, and then you can actually search for values. There are some examples in here as well. So for example, an overview of the cameras found in the EXIF information in pictures, as we showed you before. So in this case, we want to find actually entities of type phone number. And what we want to find is the entities contained in email. So we want to say, we want to find entities, but we want them to be in a trace of type email. And you can put in anything in the type email part of this query. And what you want to return, and that's also in this screenshot, what you want to return is the entity value. So you want to say entity type phone number, and give me then the entity values. And in this example, it gives you one email.
Yeah. Well, I think this is really, I want to emphasize that also to the audience, that you know, all of the forensic tools that allow you to search for documents, to artifacts in the registry, artifacts in databases. But this actually, the ability to look for values of tracelets, for example, I think that's a unique feature that you can get, and it really enables you to investigate faster and deeper and target it, because you can get an overview of all the different values of a tracelet. So I think this is a very powerful feature that you have in this value search. This is why we created a special query window that enable you to get an overview quickly of all the different values that you have for a particular tracelet, but also with value search, you can look for values of different fields.
Yes, well, and that's why we have some more examples on this.
Okay.
The next one is also a value search example. So nowadays, we see a lot of Bitcoin addresses passing by, and of course, it can be interesting to find out which Bitcoin addresses were shared via a chat application like Telegram.
Because so, the alternative, I think, normally what you would do, you can query for the pattern Bitcoin addresses, then you get all kinds of messages. Then you have to read through the messages and copy-paste all of the numbers to a separate file, so you get your report. But now, with this example, actually, we're getting a list of all the Bitcoin addresses, right?
Yes, so that's exactly what we do. So we say, well, give me all entities of type Bitcoin, where the trace is contained in a trace, which is a chat message with application Telegram. And this is a very simple query to read and to understand what you mean.
It looks complicated to me, Arm. This is not.
Does it?
Yeah, I think, well, we have a cheat sheet. There's a cheat sheet in the expert UI. It's very small print, but you can zoom in. And I see these kinds of queries. So I think, well, you as an expert, this is simple
That's
for
true.
You. But
That's
if you're just starting, I think it takes some practice. But this is why we're doing the workshop, right?
That's
to get people exposed to this kind of query.
Yes, and as you can see in the screenshot, it does return Bitcoin addresses instead of chat messages.
So if I change Telegram to, let's say, WhatsApp, then I would get Bitcoin addresses that were communicated in messages that are within WhatsApp.
Exactly. And if you replace a chat message application Telegram with type chat message, you find any Bitcoin address transferred in a chat
message. Or I do, instead of chat message, I do document.application.office. I would probably get, Excel, I would get Bitcoin addresses contained in Excel spreadsheets.
That's how it works.
I think I'm getting it, Arm.
Okay, very good.
I'm going to try this.
We'll have some more examples on this value search, since it's really powerful, as you can see. And the next example actually shows you how you can use regular expressions as well. You probably know about regular expression. It's a powerful way to describe a pattern you want to match text against. And in the example, well, say you want to look for IPv4 addresses with a specific range, like I'm only interested in the 10.0.1 or 2, and then only one digit at the end. You can do this quite advanced but still quite simple regular expression. And as you can see, you get the IP addresses returned that match this regular expression. So, and you can use these regular expressions in any place in the query language. So it's not limited to entity values or to any value. You can use it on any property you want to match a regular expression against.
Okay. So this is really where we're using some of the more powerful features, I think, also in Elasticsearch, because Elasticsearch is the backend of Hanskin, and we have put the Hanskin query language on top of that. So whenever you type in a Hanskin query in the HQL, we call it, then we translate that to an Elasticsearch query. We're getting all of the data, and we're giving you the ability to formulate regular expressions. And those can be very powerful. I think, in fact, that it's possible to make regular expressions that kind of take so much resources, they're called evil regular expressions. But I was told by the developers that they actually are trying to detect those. So if you're misforming regular expressions, then we try to detect that, and you'll get feedback, especially in the expert UI. Because I've noticed that sometimes I make a typo, then I will get a notification saying, oh, this is a property that doesn't exist. So I think there's all kinds of fallback ways. So don't be afraid to experiment with those expressions. Just try and see what gets there. And this is, well, what I understand, my regular expression experience is a bit rusty, but I recognize the round brackets, the square brackets. So the square bracket 0-9 says, well, all figures between 0 and 9, including 0 and 9, can match there.
So exactly. And the round brackets are for grouping, and the pipe symbol is for is actually the OR symbol, so one or two. And the forward slashes are the beginning and ending of a regular expression.
Yeah.
So indeed, it looks quite complex, but if you're having some experience with them, or it's easy to understand. And again, this is also contained in the documentation we have available.
Yeah. And the entities that we just showed, so we showed Bitcoin addresses, we showed phone numbers, I think you could see those as built-in regular expressions. Where during extraction, Hanskin recognizes these, and regular expressions are basically a means for the user and for the expert to formulate and to search for patterns that could be entities of a type that we do not support yet. So you can come up with anything that you like, number plates, social security numbers. If you find the right regular expression, you could actually type it in and just try it out. And there are numerous websites, I think, that show all types of different expressions. And you actually, as a digital forensic expert, I expect that you might have used this before in other tools. And this is a great way to reuse that knowledge in Hanskin.
Yes, definitely. And maybe one more thing to add on this regular expressions. They also work on all the keywords found in text contained in any trace. So what Hanskin does, it actually does is, it, if you find text, independent on where it sits, if it's the text in a Word document or text in a PDF file or text in a chat message or text in an email, Hanskin creates a big keyword index out of that, and you can use the regular expression querying on this big keyword index in general. So if you want to find something with some hit on a regular expression, but also on any keyword actually, it will give you the traces that match.
Okay, so then I have a question for you, because I know that besides like standard OCR, optical character recognition, Hanskin also does prediction where it can do OCR on kind of labels that are in a picture. So if I have a picture and there is a label in that picture which has a phone number, does that mean that it will get hit by the phone number entity and it will get hit by a regular expression?
Yes, it will.
Okay,
so
well,
also,
that's great.
If we process pictures and get some text out of that, this is text for Hanskin, so Hanskin will index it. And of course, if you get text from pictures, it might not be correct, although nowadays this works quite well. And in the end, those texts are searchable as any text is.
Well, actually, then, you know, with those errors, like, I think you mean like 1, an L, an I, or an O and a 0. Actually, you could easily solve that with regular expressions, because you could do this OR, this pipe sign, and you could say, well, it's a 1 or an I or an L.
And, yes, you can.
And build a pattern detection like that.
Create your own fuzzy patterns.
Another great feature, Harm. Great.
So another thing you maybe want to do is look at the contents of pictures and see what's in there. Hanskin does this based on some libraries, as Hanskin mentioned, developed and tested at the Netherlands Forensics Institute. And Well, finding pictures that probably contain firearms can already be done without querying using the investigative interfaces. So what you can do is say, give me all the pictures, and then order them on this classification, order them on how sure Hansken is, or how sure the model is that a firearm was in this picture. And this can be done without querying. Of course, underwater, the query is sent to Hansken. And we will explain the query now. So what you first do is you say, well, I'm interested in pictures. Give me everything of type picture. And then give me everything which is predicted to be a firearm. So it has the classification. It's in the class firearm with some confidence. And you have to combine these two things, the class firearm and the confidence, for example, 0.8. So I'm 80% sure there's a firearm in there. It's not really what it means, but it's how you can think of it. And by putting these in the curly brackets, it means I want predictions where this combination of classification and confidence occurs. If you leave out the brackets and say I'm prediction class firearm and prediction confidence something bigger than 0.8, then it can be that you have a prediction class firearm, which is 0.1, and a prediction something else, which is 0.8, and then it matches this picture as well. But by using curly brackets and then combining, well, properties within the properties, you can do queries like this. And then we have a lot of classification which is focusing on the things that occur in criminal investigations, like firearms or drugs or cash money or bank cards or screens, since you see people taking pictures of screens instead of sending the screenshot or sending the screens themselves. And we can find them and classify them and with some confidence present them, and you can use that for querying as well.
Okay, and I can see that's getting a bit more complicated now, because now we have this those curly brackets, putting them together. I also see that we are entering this in the tactical user interface, because we in the beginning we saw the technical user interface, and this is what we're looking now at is the tactical, so for the non-technical investigators. But I saw that you can still enter HQL, so you can still Hansken query language, I think, by using the advanced radio button.
Yes, that's true. Interface. So actually the tactical case investigative interface, which is this screenshot presenting, is geared towards case investigators that don't have a really big IT background, but they know how to, well, find a book on Amazon. And what we do is we help them out with drop-down lists and other things to query Hansken. But if you know a query language, or if you are a more skilled digital expert and you still want to use this interface, since it has some nice features to present results, then you can do a text search and put it on advanced mode, and then you can actually type in any Hansken query language query and use it the way
great.
You can do.
Nice. So we have a different user interface if you're really expert, or if you're not so expert and you're starting, this is the interface that you can use, really allows you to, so you don't have to type in advanced queries, you can actually use the drop-down menus to compile a query, and it automatically has the correct syntax.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And to be honest, when I'm doing an investigation, I use the expert user interface. I use the case investigative interface. There's also an Intel interface we use now and then. And we can also do everything we showed you today with Python using scripting. So in any investigation, I think the experts use any interface depending on what their need is at the moment.
Sounds excellent.
Okay, next example. We don't have any screenshots or pictures here because it's about a CSAM example. So it's child sexual abuse material. But it's a typical investigation you see. So in such investigations, you are often interested in pictures and videos which shouldn't be carved and from a specific time range or a specific period. And actually, this is showing you how you can combine multiple queries to create one big query. And this is also the way you use it for filtering. So you start with everything. You say, I'm interested in pictures or videos. And you can use binary operators, like the OR. And with the brackets, you can make combinations. So I'm interested in traces of type picture or type video, which also contain some CSAM word, for example, like this one, and which also are not type carved. So we didn't explain it yet. I think when you're familiar with Hanskin, you know Hanskin has a trace model where a trace can be multiple things concurrently. So it can be a picture, but it can also be carved. Or it can be an email attachment, and it can be a Word document. And that's also the way we, as human beings, look at our digital material. When I'm talking about an email attachment because I send it to somebody, I say, look at the attachment. When I opened this attachment, which was a picture in my photo app, I'm talking about it as being a picture. And it's the same thing at the same time. So the Hanskin trace model is actually naming this thing an attachment and a picture. And if you're looking for attachments, you will find it. If you're looking for pictures, you will find it as well. Things can be files in a file system, but they can also be carved when they are found in the unallocated space of a disk, for example. And if a picture is carved, then it will have type picture and it will have type carved. And you can say, give me everything of type picture not being type carved, and then you will find all the other pictures.
I like this example, Harm, because I also teach to students. And one of the e-discovery search strategies is always, you know about recall and precision. So with recall means that are you getting everything there is? And precision is actually, do I also get things that I don't want to see? And in this strategy where you use OR to increase recall, because you're increasing everything that you retrieve, so the chances that you find something that is relevant are bigger, but you're getting more hits that are not so interesting. So then is where the NOT comes in, or AND, because then you're going to restrict. And the NOT typically is a good operator to increase precision. So now we can leave out things that we think are not relevant for our search. And the next step after that is that hopefully by doing this, you've reduced the number of results to an amount that are manageable through review. So it's a great three-step process that you can follow as an investigator. And by using the Hanskin query language, you can actually do this step by step and always exactly describe what you've been searching for. So it's a great example of how to do that.
Yeah, and still, well, this one is not finished yet, since we also said we want everything after 2016. We showed you the dates before. So you can just keep combining results, queries to reduce your result set. And as increasing you said, review them by the time you're
And increasing the precision by just saying, well, I'm not interested for anything that's older than 2016. So that's a great way to reduce that. And type carve reminds me that sometimes people just want to see for deleted information. Can we search for deleted information with the Hanskin query model?
Yeah, so type carved, if you have carved stuff, of course, that's from deleted material or, well, at least an allocated space.
But if it's in the recycle bin, it's not really gone yet, right?
Yeah, so we also have a type deleted,
okay.
Which, because in a file system, you can have files that are still in the file system table, but marked deleted, depending on the file system type. And this marking being deleted is also added as a type to the traces. Same holds for example, deleted emails. So if you're interested in things that are deleted, you can look for them and find them.
Okay, well, it's good to know.
And, well, here you see some examples of binary operators. There are some abbreviations. So, for example, the NOT, you can also use the minus sign. Look at the cheat sheet or look at the manual. It's all in there.
So it's basically the Boolean search operators, AND or NOT, and the shortcuts, like you say, minus sign. I think there's a within or proximity operator in there. There's, I think, a lot of features supported by the Hanskin.
Yeah, so it's
language.
like the bigger than and
bigger
the smaller
than,
than
and the bigger range equal. Queries. So if I would like to do those dates greater than 2016. If I wanted to include 2016, I could do greater than equal sign, probably.
Exactly.
Okay, easy. So it's still easy.
It's this. And the default operator is the AND sign. So if you just start typing like we did in the previous examples, it's just you, well, queries must match all parts of your query.
So Harm, now you are an investigator, right? So what's the biggest Hanscom query that you've ever made?
Oh, that's a complex question. I think with at least 10 of these components combined.
Impressive. And then, do you have to put it in your report saying, oh, I use this query? And
we do, but not all queries end up in our reports, luckily. Otherwise, our reports would be hundreds of pages. But it's all written down and captured for
In the Hanscom audit trail, right? Because we keep an audit trail of what happened. Yep, great. And I think you can save queries also. I think they added this feature some time ago that you can, if you have a complex query, you want to save that for later use, you can actually say save query.
Yeah, so that's happening inside, but actually outside Hanscom. So Hanscom also comes with a preference service where you can store preferences like your the language of your user interface you want to use. It's multilingual. And this preference service can also be used for storing other information like the queries you ran lately. And it's possible to share those with others as well.
Yeah.
Okay, next one. And this is getting even more complex as we already are. Find all duplicates of a file sent as email attachment. So here we already found something, namely a specific email attachment. Here you can see the report. It's a JPEG file. And actually, it's this file, not really interesting. Well, it's interesting, of course, because you want to find duplicates. And how you can do that is, well, you can nest queries. And the way this works is you can match on properties that are contained with the same values in your subquery. So when you want to find duplicates, you typically use hashes. So you can say, I'm interested in all traces where the MD5 hash of the raw data corresponds to any of the MD5 hashes of the inner query. And the inner query you can put with a dollar sign and then brackets. And in this example, well, my inner query can be, for example, an attachment with a name, the name of the attachment. So you then get, it looks up the attachment with that name. You get a range of MD5s. Well, this is only one file, so you get one MD5. And then the outer query says, give me all traces with a matching MD5. And in this example, you can see, actually, there's two hits. It's the attachment itself, which was expected, of course. But it's also carved from some unallocated space. And, well, if you have a case with multiple evidence items, so with for example, a computer and a telephone and a USB drive, then if you find something on one computer, you can do a query like this and then find duplicates on other machines as well. Or find everything that sits on one machine and see where it sits on another machine.
Yeah, so that's useful because I see that the other hit is actually, it doesn't have a file name. The file name carved was generated by Hanscom. So if I have just looked for the file name, I wouldn't have found that file. But now, because I'm using this query, I actually find files that have, well, like you say, that were carved. Interesting. So I think this is interesting if you're looking into a data leakage case, or did somebody leak data outside? So did they have a file on their system and did they put it in an email to send it out? And now you can make a link between those different files, or the same files actually, on different places, or maybe even on different evidence items.
Yeah, so I used it in a case where I had a USB drive with five files on it, and the question was, where do these files sit in other places? So then you can say, well, give me all traces with a matching MD5 or SHA-1. And then in the inner query, you can just say, device, is this USB drive? So then it says, well, give me every evidence item from this USB drive, get all MD5s out of that, and then do a big query on any of these MD5s in my entire data set. And this is really powerful because it's just a one-liner to write it down, and it's a really powerful operation in the back end.
It's actually interesting that you're saying and talking about evidence items. So how many evidence items can I have in a Hanscom case?
Well, we've done cases, at least the Dutch law enforcement organizations have done cases with over 1,000 evidence items in one case.
1,000? So the tools that I typically use, 5 hard disks. or 10 phones, and then that was it. But more than 1,000 evidence items.
Yeah, exactly. And we have also done cases with over 100 million traces, so where one trace is an email or a chat message or a picture. So
that's really impressive.
That's a big number.
But then they have lots of hardware, right? Because you need lots of hardware.
You need a lot of hardware to be responsive in such data sets.
Okay. Yep.
But Hanscom is able to actually use that hardware and make it still responsive if you have that amount of data and get results on queries within seconds.
Okay. So do we have more, Harm?
I think we're almost there, but we have our final one, which is find pictures with three faces.
So three faces, like in people faces?
Yes, like in, well, we are with two faces.
We are now with two faces in the picture.
Pictures with three faces. And the way this works is actually we store it currently in a miscellaneous field near pictures, simply because we didn't have a very nice place in our trace model to store it. But what we do is we have a tool to identify objects in pictures. Objects can be faces, so we have a face recognition tool. And because we can recognize faces, we can also count them and store the number of faces in the trace model. So you can say, well, give me every picture with a face count of three. And then, well, you can see the results. Yeah. They are quite promising.
That typically, they're all three faces. Good.
Yeah, so this works quite well, and this is really helpful. And at the moment, we are also looking at, well, doing this in an even more advanced stuff, especially with faces. See if we can find similar faces given the face we have at our...
I think I saw a demo of our developers, right? Because they do demos every 3 weeks. We do a sprint demo, we see new features. Sometimes there's an innovation sprint, and we do really innovative stuff. So I think what I saw there is what Harm mentions, is that if you go from a picture, then you go to the expert UI, you can actually say to Hanscom, show me the regions where the faces are. And then you can say, I want to find all pictures that have this, or with faces that look like this one, right?
Yes, that's exactly what we use. So we extended the trace model with vectors. And if you can, well, do similarity matches on your vectors, you can actually find similar stuff. And we do this for faces now, at least in our demo environment. And I think it's about to be ready for production.
I think that's really interesting. And I think if we would do this again next year, Then maybe those will be existing features. We could actually show that, because I think the whole vectorization models, where we, I think, changing from Boolean search into vector search opens up a whole range of new applications, not only for pictures, but I think also for text. If you join us at the community days, we will always look ahead and show those innovations and talk about them, and even have the developers talk about those innovations that are slowly coming to Hanscom.
Exactly. So, well, I think this is about what we want to present today on the Hanscom query language. Well, and don't forget, the documentation is out there via the expert user interface. And everything we showed you today can also be done via the scripting API. So if you saw the queries and you think, well, this is nice stuff to get my results presented differently from a user interface, well, use Python, script against Hanscom, and... Well, that's, I think, next level.
Just the other day, I saw a great example. We got a question from police. It was picked up by our developers, the scripting developers. And one of the things that Hanscom already does is photo DNA. I think photo DNA is a kind of the fuzzy image hashing that Microsoft has put out. And I saw a nice script that could actually download photo DNA strings of pictures, and then in the script calculate how similar those images are together. So hopefully at one time this will be inside Hanscom, but already with the scripting API, you can do this kind of queries, advanced queries. So Harm, I want to thank you. I think I really learned a lot during this workshop. I'm going to try it out on my Hanscom system, on the demo server, whenever I get my hands on Hanscom. So it was great. And I'm looking forward to an update, maybe next year.
Very good. Well, thank you. Definitely next year and probably earlier.
Okay, thank you.